I was afraid for a second.
Vince says snitches get stitches. That's right.
Yeah, so...
no, snitches get killed.
Oh. All right. I've just started recording.
Snitches. You stitch a snitch and they're just going to snitch on you.
We put snitches in ditches.
Yes,
there you go.
That's way more accurate. Awesome.
I like that. I like that a lot. All right, so I'm just going to scroll down my script here. So my role is a scroller. I'm going to scroll the script while you guys read. And thank you guys so much for doing this. Greg, are you ready to go?
Yeah.
Everybody's in the voice channel ready to go?
Yep.
Yes, I am.
Yeah.
Yep. Whee! So exciting. All right, and begin.
Log by Alison Parker. Sticks and stones may break your bones, but log will fucking kill you.
I don't hear anything.
Just say you couldn't hear me.
Oh, yep.
I heard him the entire time.
Okay, sorry. Can you start from the beginning? I accidentally muted you. I'm sorry. I don't think my stream would have heard you. I'm so sorry. I heard you say, but log will fucking kill you.
Uh-huh.
Can you go
from
there?
He read that so well, too.
Oh, yeah. Right,
it was beautiful. You're beautiful.
Go into it.
We're going to restart. We're going to restart.
All right, take two.
And
you know what? Do it with less animation.
Yeah. Okay. No. Okay, and action.
From the top.
You don't lie there like a log. All right, interior, log cabin, night. Carrie, 29. Tank top under denim overalls, joint tucked behind her ear. Paces back and forth, hands gesturing wildly as she mumbles unintelligibly to herself. Super prologue. Carrie enters a doorway, then reemerges, removing her shirt, unknowingly exposing her bare breasts to the point of view of an unseen observer. Someone watches from outside the cabin's rain-soaked window as Carrie pulls a white nightgown over her head. A charred log smolders in the fire lane. Carrie sticks it with a fire poker. It disintegrates into black ash. Exterior woods, night. A shovel stabs into a mound of wet, loose dirt as torrential rain pelts the forest floor. A tap unfurls to reveal the dead body of a teen girl wearing cut-off denim shorts and a bloody Junior Lumberjacks t-shirt. Her face is covered in lacerations. Wyatt, 32, red plaid shirt, suspenders, jeans covered in blood, gags at the gruesome sight. He turns and in one fluid motion spews vomit into the grave he just dug.
Jesus, titty fucking Christ.
Riot rolls the body into the hole. She lands with a thud and several eerie cracks as bones break within her. In the grave's point of view, Wyatt pours two buckets of blood, guts, and hacked up body parts on top of us. The rain washes us clean. Point of view, unseen observer. Someone watches as Wyatt gags again. He falls to his knees, retching yellow bile into one of the buckets. Wyatt, if you want to pretend you're vomiting right now, go for it. Back to scene. A log rolls through the wet grass and stops a few feet behind the vomiting Wyatt. Stealth. Undetected. The log is about knee-high, 1 foot in diameter, with thick, cracked bark and a stubby, broken branch near the top. A tiny oak leaf sprouts from the end of the branch. The log tips upright. Wyatt stands, attempts to light a smoke in the rain.
Fuck me, eh?
Log flies through the air and stabs its branch to the back of Wyatt's neck. Wyatt's head jolts back. The branch protrudes from his throat. Blood sprays out like a garden hose nozzle. Cut to CAT scan shot, Log's body. See the inside of Log's body as if sliced in half. We zoom in on the blood, which spirals and circles up the tube-shaped xylem and arrives at a beating heart. Back to scene. Slurp! Wyatt's eyes widen as the log drinks his blood. Bright orange light glows from within the cracks in Log's bark as it shakes viciously, tearing away at the flesh. Wyatt staggers in circles, clutching the branch in his throat, spewing a blood vomit fountain from his neck. Glug, glug, glug. The life drains from Wyatt's face. He falls to the ground next to the shovel, dead.
Dear Mrs. Martinez, we are very sorry Marissa couldn't make it to Junior Lumberjack's. We were looking forward to meeting her.
Log dislodges from Wyatt's neck and rolls away with great speed and gusto, bouncing wildly like a kid on Ritalin. Interior, log cabin, night. Carrie sits at a small desk in the corner of the room. She writes furiously while smoking the joint previously tucked behind her ear, her eyes red from being stoned.
We were surprised when Marissa never showed up. No. We were worried when she didn't show up.
Pencil snaps from being pushed down so hard.
Damn it!
Carrie's head whips around, spooked.
Who's there?
Carrie extinguishes her joint, peers out the window. She opens the door. Nobody there. Looks down. From her point of view, it's Log.
What the hell?
Blood drips from Log's branch.
Wyatt?
Log vibrates. The orange light glows within the cracks. Carrie's eyes go wide. Splinters of bark shoot out from log-like quills like a porcupine. They pierce the walls, a painting, and shoo, a dagger-like splinter stabs Carrie in the forearm. Blood gushes from the wound. She screams in pain. Log chases Carrie into the bedroom. Blood-curdling screams. End prologue. Music, an upbeat 50s song, plays on warm, cracking vinyl. No one's playing the record player? All right. In Shady Pines Asylum, patient's room, day. Sunshine and the cheerful sounds of a doo-wop fill a small hospital room as a needle rides the grooves of a record. Super, 21 years later. Rubber-gloved hands spray disinfectant on a windowsill. Scrub the ledge with a sponge and wipe down the vents in a running AC unit.
There's way too much dirt in this place. And they think we should be paying more? Ridiculous.
An aged, disheveled-looking Carrie sits in the edge of a bed, staring at a blank television screen. Her eyes are vacant. Her eyelids droop slightly as if she's sedated. A wilted daisy is tucked behind her ear. Erica, 21, red plaid shirt over white tank top, wipes down the remote control, removes her rubber gloves, and cracks her knuckles. The sound is eerie and loud.
I swear, you'd be better off at home with me.
Erica sits, rubs her right wrist as she speaks off.
Did my dad like doo-wop?
A spot of drool collects in the corner of Carrie's lips.
Sometimes I have this fantasy that we're sitting at the breakfast table. All three of us, just eating pancakes together. I wish you could tell me about him, about you both.
She removes the daisy tucked behind Carrie's ear and replaces it with a fresh one. She kisses her forehead.
I love you, Mom.
Erica uses a tissue to discard the old flower in the trash can, then uses it again to open the door and leave. Interior, Shady Pines Asylum in the hallway. Erica passes Nurse Helen in her 40s, frumpy.
Hey, sweet pea, are you on your way to administration?
Not today. I don't have time.
I'm sure there can be something worked out. There's a great facility out there in Nyack for half the price.
I'm not moving my mother to Nyack.
Erica rubs her wrists. Helen notices.
You're way too young to have arthritis.
Erica rotates her hand. It crackles like pop rocks.
Probably carpal tunnel. All that typing from school.
Why don't you let me take a look at it? We could do some blood test.
Helen reaches for Erica's hand, but she yanks it away.
I'm fine, thanks. I'll see you tomorrow, Helen.
She passes more catatonic patients in wheelchairs as she heads for the exit. Using the tissue to push the lever, she grabs a squirt of hand sanitizer from a dispenser and walks through the automatic doors into the white light outside. In the car in the parking lot, Erica sits behind the wheel and straps on a black Velcro wristband. She cleans her hands with a wet wipe. Nicole, late 40s, a large Latino woman, bangs on Erica's driver's side window. Erica rolls it down.
Can I help you?
Erica?
Do I know?
Nicole reaches in and grabs Erica by the throat.
I know you, bitch. You're the spawn of that psycho slut.
Nicole squeezes Erica's neck with a ferocious intensity.
You got the wrong...
You think I don't know? That catatonic skank killed my Joey.
Erica struggles to pry Nicole's hands from her neck.
Stop. I can't. Breathe.
Meanwhile, in the Shady Trees Asylum, Nurse Helen walks out, pushing a patient in a wheelchair, and notices Nicole strangling Erica in the parking lot.
Security! Security!
In the car.
help!
Nicole releases her grip. Erica gasps for air, coughing.
I'll be back!
She frantically rolls up the window, starts up her car, and burns rubber. She hightails it out of the parking lot. Nicole walks over to a red pickup truck, but first, she flips Nurse Helen the bird with both hands.
Fuck you, Helen.
Off Helen's lip. Exterior, Erica's house. Erica's car pulls into the driveway of a modest house. The perfectly manicured lawn accents a tiny rock garden. Chuck, 22, blue plumber's jumpsuit, sits on the front steps. He stands to greet Erica as she exits the car.
Chuck, you shouldn't be here.
Just tell me what's wrong, please.
Erica rubs her throat. Chuck notices the red marks.
Shit, what happened?
It's nothing.
Erica opens the door. Chuck follows her inside to the house in the living room, where she drops the keys next to an immaculate aquarium of crystal clear water and brightly colored fish. Chuck sits on the couch and grabs a small bottle of hand sanitizer from the side table, lathers his hands up. Erica cracks a slight smile, appreciating the effort. She cleans the germs from her neck with a wet wipe.
Shit, it is really fucked up right now. I just need some space.
I'm not leaving until you talk to me, Erica.
Erica grabs a peach from a bowl on the kitchen counter.
My mom has to be moved to a new facility. Some crazy Mexican lady tried to strangle me today. And oh yeah, my boyfriend refuses to eat my...
Chuck bites into the pitch, slurps up its juices loudly.
It wasn't like that. I didn't refuse. I tried. It just...
He wipes his mouth and tries to kiss Erica on the cheek.
Forget it.
Erica pushes Chuck away and heads for the kitchen. A red light in the landline phone flashes.
Wait, someone tried to kill you?
Just get out, Chuck, please.
Chuck gazes into Erica's eyes, caresses her arm, but she's stone cold.
Fine.
Chuck leaves. When he's gone, Erica hits the button on the answering machine. Beep!
Hi, Erica, this is Lenny Abrams, your mother's lawyer. We got some legal matters to take care of now that you're 21, specifically the land that your mother left you.
Erica pops a few prescription pills at the glass of water.
Land?
Carrie left me specific instructions before she became, well, incapacitated. We need to discuss what you'd like to do. Please call me at 555-6745.
Erica washes the glass in the sink, scrubbing diligently. She sets the cup upside down in the cloth.
Grandmother never told me about any land.
Interior, the lawyer's office. Lenny Abrams, 70s, thumbs through a filing cabinet. He pulls out a folder, sits at his desk, and opens it. He moves like a sloth with Parkinson's disease.
She didn't want you going out there. All those rusty saw blades and such. It's decent size. We should be able to sell it easily.
Erica pulls out a flyer. It shows Carrie and Wyatt standing next to the Junior Lumberjacks camp entrance gate. Happy times. Erica's thumb touches Wyatt's face.
Junior Lumberjacks?
It was a camp for the troubled youth.
She notices a termite crawling along Lenny's desk. She scrunches her nose in disgust, and she clenches her fist.
Did you know my father?
I can't discuss that with you. I'm afraid.
Why not? There's nobody else who can tell me. Did you meet him?
I met somebody.
Her eyes are locked in the termite as she talks.
I know why it is my father. He was my mother's husband. Who else would it be?
Termite crawls onto a pen pointed in Erica's direction. She narrows her eyes, staring it down.
I have someone take an assessment of the property next week.
She cracks her knuckles, loud. The sound sends chills down Lenny's spine, and the termite scurries off the pen.
If this place was so special to my parents, I should go there before I sell it. I could fix it up.
Termite's head has disappeared into a divot in the oak desk, its thorax and abdomen wriggling in the air.
There are people we can get to take care of that for you.
No, it has to be me.
Lenny sighs, pushes the papers into the folder, and shakes his way back over to the filing cabinet.
If you dig up the past, you're gonna get dirty.
Smash! Erica slams her fist onto the desk, squashing the termite. Lenny jumps startled, clutching his chest.
I'd rather get dirt than live the rest of my life not knowing where I came from.
Lenny closes his eyes, then removes a VHS tape from the cabinet. He slides it towards Erica on the desk.
This is where you came from.
The tape's labeled Junior Lumberjacks, July 22nd, 1995. Exterior college day. A frantic hippie girl hands out Save the Trees flyers as masses of college kids walk by, ignoring her.
Did you know that 6.4 million acres of forest are destroyed each year?
Frantic hippie shoves a flyer into the hands of Todd. I can't keep calm. I'm a software developer, t-shirt, and khaki shorts.
Great. How can I help?
He pushes his glasses up as they droop down in his nose.
With just a tiny donation, we can help you put an end to deforestation.
No, no. How can I help deforestation? I don't want to put an end to it.
Excuse me?
Frantic hippie tilts her head like a confused pug.
Did you know over 100 people are killed by falling trees in the United States every year?
What's your deal, man?
Too funny.
Todd crumples the paper and tosses it.
My deal is only a psychopath would want to save the trees.
Erica intercepts Todd, drags him by the arm away from frantic hippie, who goes back to yelling at the passerby.
What are you doing? You really need to get a grip on your hylophobia.
Hylophobia is an irrational fear of trees. My hatred of them is 100% rational. A psych major should know these things.
I can't know whether or not your fear is rational if you don't tell me what happened.
Why can't you just let sleeping dogs lie? Oh, right, you're Erica.
Erica removes the VHS tape from her bag and shows Todd.
Check this out.
He grabs the tape.
Wow. VHS. Doing your thesis on the downfall of Blockbuster Video?
What?
Never mind. What's on it?
My parents, I think. I need to find a way to play this thing.
The film department is a tomb of ancient analog technology.
She furrows her brow.
Like a VCR. VCR plays VHS.
Off Erica's smile, we transition to the inside of the college in the film storage room. A small room of shelves covered in various film equipment. Reels, camcorders, DVD players, TVs, cables, etc. Todd plugs in a TV-VCR combo and pushes in the VHS tape.
You sure you want to go through with this?
She hits play with the remote control. A cheesy retro graphic for Junior Lumberjacks Camp spins on the screen. Various shots of laughing teenagers, log rolling, tree climbing, sawing, axe throwing, dissolve into each other with diamond-shaped transitions.
Wow.
Young Carrie and Wyatt stand next to the entrance gate of the log rolling place.
Is your son or daughter a troubled teenager, filled with rage and addicted to drugs? Why not send them to Junior Lumberjacks?
Carrie points to the junior lumberjack sign behind her, an animatronic lumberjack swinging an axe above a log.
Hi, I'm Wyatt Hudson, champion log roller from Nova Scotia, Canada. Here at Junior Lumberjacks, we provide a genuine experience that will keep your kid off the crack and on the log.
Carrie interrupts a teen boy lighting a crack pipe in the forest. She wags her finger in his face disapprovingly. He gives her a cheesy, "Aw man, I'm so busted" expression. In the next shot, the boy's seen rubbing sticks together to create a small fire and uses the flame to light up his pipe instead. Carrie and Wyatt give us the thumbs up. Tears well up in Erica's eyes. She's transfixed.
It's an exciting blend of outdoor adventure, culture, history, and rehabilitation for troubled teens all rolled up into one.
Send your juvenile delinquent to Junior Lumberjacks today.
An ad for Pop Rocks plays next. Todd stops the tape.
Are you okay?
We have to go there.
Did you see all of those trees?
Consider it therapy.
I do not need therapy, Erica.
Well, I need you. To help me, I mean. I have to fix this place up and get it ready to sell.
Can't you hire someone? You might not like what you find out there.
I don't care. Dylan and Kiwi are picking me up in the morning.
No Chuck?
We broke up.
Todd pushes up his glasses, masking his excitement.
Do they have Wi-Fi there?
She smiled. Exterior Erica's house, morning. Erica exits her front door, backpack slung over her shoulder, carrying several shopping bags from Home Depot. A white 1988 Pontiac Firebird with the red bird in the hood and flames in the side revs in the driveway. Vroom,
vroom. Woohoo! Erica! Fuck yeah!
Kiwi 20, a smoking hot brunette with dreadlocks and a rack made for motorboating, steps out of the passenger side of the car and let Erica into the back.
Hey!
Kiwi passes Erica a lit joint.
Hey, check this out. Strawberries and cream, man.
Erica takes a hoot.
Smooth.
Whoa, what happened to your neck?
Oh, it's nothing.
Chuck emerges from the back seat, much to Erica's surprise.
Right, sure.
Kiwi gives Chuck a dirty look, suspicious of Erica's bruises. She slowly lowers herself back into the car, never breaking her stare with Chuck.
Hey, thought you could use a piping specialist. Hope you don't mind.
Cardiologist?
Shut it, Dylan.
It's fine. I could really use your help, actually. Thank you.
Chuck smiles. In the car, Dylan, 21, sleeveless Dio shirt, grips his chrome skull steering wheel.
Ready to party, America!
Please stop calling me that.
Just teasing you.
Erica's squeezed tightly between Chuck and Todd in the backseat. It's mega awkward, to say the least.
Hey.
Thanks for coming.
Chuck holds a bright yellow plunger on his lap.
Couldn't you have put that in the trunk?
He tries to brush the germs off her shirts.
Sorry, trunk's full.
Chuck sticks the plunger between his legs.
Did you bring the tools?
Got mine right here.
Dylan grabs his crotch and winks at Kiwi.
You also brought the beer.
Chuck cracks open a can of Old Milwaukee.
A lot of beer. Trunk's loaded.
Yeah, my parents hooked me up with some new strains from the depensatory.
Oh,
whatever.
We can party tonight, I promise. Let's just get there and see what shape it's in first.
You got it, America.
Dylan gears into reverse, peels out of the driveway. Erica's point of view. Erica watches through the back window as Nicole stands in the middle of the street, pointing and marking her throat with her finger, the international symbol for "you're dead."
Got you, Erica.
Off Erica's horrified look. Here, you got that, Allison? Write that line of dialogue.
I heard Puta.
I'll bet you, Puta. Off Erica's horrified look, exterior gravel road, morning. The Firebird zooms down the gravel road, surrounded by thick green forest. A rooster tail of dust billows behind the car and hangs in the air. The song Blood Death Fire by Scandinavian metal band Deathface blasts from the radio. The kids sing along.
Stop the car!
Then it slams hard in the brakes. The car skids to a stop. In the car, Todd and Chuck lurch forward. Their heads bounce off the seats in front of them.
Chuck, what's up?
Let me out.
Are you car sick? You can use my vaporizer. Yeah, I fix you right up.
Pee-wee opens the door and Chuck and Erica squeeze out of the back seat. Todd joins them.
I'm not sick, I saw something.
Todd's point of view, oak trees, maple trees, fir trees, pine trees. Todd gasps for air and hyperventilates. Erica puts her hands on his shoulders.
It's okay, just breathe.
Todd buffs his glasses with his shirt, regaining his composure as others exit the car.
I'm fine. Why did we stop?
I saw a beaver.
Erica, you've been holding out on us, do tell.
No, like a real beaver.
A large beaver lies on its side on the gravel, its bloody tail caught in what appears to be a bear trap.
Oh my god!
The beaver whimpers. It struggles to move, but the heavy trap's holding it down.
Oh my god. That's so bad. Poor thing.
Bring me the tools.
Chuck grabs the toolbox and sets it down next to Todd.
I will do it. Move over.
Just let Todd do it.
He stands between Chuck and Erica so he can't see what's going on, giving him the evil eye again.
What?
Dude, you gotta know what.
Beaver flaps its tail. The spikes dig deeper.
Shh, it's okay.
Erica strokes the beaver's head as Todd uses the pliers to unlock the trap.
I thought you only knew how to use computers.
There's lots of things you don't know.
What's that supposed to mean?
The beaver's freed. It looks at Todd and Erica, lingers for several moments, and scurries away.
That was amazing.
No biggie.
Off Chuck's look. Exterior junior lumberjack camp entrance. Party of five behold the abandoned lumberjack camp.
What a dump.
Savage.
Your mom really had a thing for lumberjacks, huh?
Todd pushes up his glasses.
You've got to be kidding me.
A faded wooden sign depicts a giant lumberjack holding an axe above a log. Go to hell, skank! Is spray-painted beneath the Junior Lumberjacks camp insignia.
Why would somebody do this?
It was probably just some stupid kids. I'm sure they aren't talking about your mother.
We'll plan over it.
Fuck yeah, definitely.
Behind the gate, several log cabins surround the camp. Various lumberjack activities. A log-rolling pool, tree-climbing stations, axe-throwing range, cross-cut swing. As the others head towards the car, Todd takes in the surroundings. Trees everywhere.
Awesome.
Point of view of an unseen observer. Someone watches behind the trees as the kids unload the trunk of the car and make their way to the log cabin. End
it's,
scene.
It's
yay.
Log.
Yay!
Good job, you guys. I'm clapping for you guys. That was awesome.
I'm hitting on my keyboard.
Yes.
I'm actually hitting on my chest like a gorilla.
Oh, do it.
Boy, that scream was brutal. Why did you give me that line?
I love it. And you did it twice, actually.
That was awesome.
That was like the best part was Erica's scream. And oh, no. The best part was right, Clown
yeah.
reading the frantic hippie. Like she
yes,
was super sexual.
Hippie,
I that scene. The frantic hippie scene was honestly very delightful.
That was really good.
Better, instead of being a frantic hippie, being like a more of a laid back hippie.
Yeah. Yeah, that was actually really funny to hear it like that.
Seriously, though. Like, how can I continue deforestation?
So, Smish, who's your favorite character? Is it Lenny? Do you like
Oh,
Lenny?
Yeah, definitely.
It's all
No, everybody did a really great job. I mean, Judy really made me laugh because I've just never heard her speak this way. Like, normally Judy, I think, doesn't even allow swearing on her channel. Like, in the chat, you get banned.
Yeah, that
instantly.
that was eye-opening for
yeah,
me, Judy.
Like, that was
where did that come from?
Judy not only read the swears that were in the script, she added extra swears
she added
in there.
So many swear words.
That ad-libbing was on point.
That was so, funny. Yeah, you did. I love how you read Nurse Helen. I never thought of her that way, so that was really interesting. I didn't think of her as, like, you read her, like, scary, you know? And then so Erica responded to how you were reading her by acting like, no, I'm fine, like, leave me alone, right? But it worked. I liked it. I was picturing her, like, really, really sweet, calls everyone sweetie, like, really motherly towards Erica, feels so bad for her, you know, her mom is in this asylum. And then you read her, like,
she was
scary.
Creepy. Like,
she was creepy. She was creepy.
Well, I mean, she banged her hand out of her, so I thought, well...
Yeah, well, the way you did it was funnier than what I imagined. Yeah. So I feel like that's a good example of how I want to go back now and make sure that's in the writing that so that everyone would read it that way, that she's super fucking creepy.
Is it terrible that I, like, in my head, though, I imagine, like, Betty White having that voice? So it's just, like, it's a really weird combination of that, the script, and Judy's voice, which was awesome.
Yeah, she sounded really old also. Like, I wrote that she was in her 40s, but she sounded like she was, like, 70, maybe.
And I liked what you did with all the Kiwi ad-libs, because she is supposed to be stoned, so it worked that you added, like, all of that extra context around what she was saying.
Mm-hmm.
Thanks. I was going to have her laugh a little bit more, like she laughs at punctuation, but I didn't quite get there.
Oh, I really like what you did. The only thing that you missed a little is that Kiwi is suspicious of Chuck. Basically, she thinks that Chuck has put the bruises on Erica's neck. So that's
I wasn't sure how to do that and still be, like, on drugs, you know?
Gotcha. As long as you understood that when you were reading, because if you didn't, I would feel like, oh, no, I need to go back and make that more clear, because it's not clear that, like, she's really worried about Erica.
I got that. I just didn't think that she would be that coherent.
Right.
But maybe I thought she was a little too high.
That's okay.
I mean, it would be really funny just, like, to make her sound paranoid if you ever decide to do that again. Just, like, it's like, you know what you did.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, just paranoid all the way around?
I don't know.
No?
That's more of an acting thing, honestly. But...
This draft is a lot stronger than the previous draft, Smish.
Okay, don't rip me apart, Madge. You always rip me apart.
No, I'm glad that you took the time to establish Erica as a main character and then interconnect with the other kids and actually have some time to appreciate the characters before everything happens. It's way stronger than the previous draft. It's a lot
better. Thank you so much. For those who don't know, I wrote the first draft of Log entirely on Twitch. I wrote it on Twitch in about 2 weeks, and obviously it wasn't amazing. And then I wrote a second draft on Twitch, and this is the third draft, which has gone through several revisions. And Greg, who is reading our action lines, you gave me some feedback the other night. Remember when I used to have a 10-page prologue? And you gave me some feedback about a scene that you thought was weak, and I ended up just basically cutting my 10-page prologue down to 3 pages. And everything that we don't see is going to just be revealed in a different way to Erica throughout. So, for example, the Lumberjack commercial on VHS tape. I wrote that scene just this morning. Did you guys like that scene? Do you think it was funny?
Yeah, it was great.
Okay.
Yeah, I liked it.
Cool. I'm glad.
Oh, it's a nice throwback, the use of the VHS, the things you had. It's funny. Having the kid, because it's a real commercial within the genre of your script, having the kid light the crack pipe with the fire from the sticks, itself is funny because it allows you to add like this level of hyper surrealism to the commercial, you know.
Right.
It's good. It's good writing.
Oh, wow. Thank you so much.
The only
really
thing
that
might have been a little weak is mm-hmm. when you have the peach / eating out a girl joke, it's a little mm-hmm. on the nose. It's because it's kind of random that she would be complaining about that to him immediately as soon as you get to know the character. But we do
right.
have the whole like, it's on page 8, the top of page 8.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was actually going to comment about that too. That seemed a little weird to me, but I mean, I kind of got it as well.
So. Originally, it was more on the nose. Originally, she said, "My boyfriend refuses to eat my pussy." And he says, "I want to eat your pussy." And then I had somebody read it just this morning who gave me the feedback of it might be a bit on the nose. Maybe you could use like a visual clue
yeah,
about
but
what
I
they're
know.
Talking about. So I changed it.
It doesn't make sense. Erica is the one who has a germophobia like Monk.
Yeah.
So why would her boyfriend have a problem with that? It would be her. She would think it would be
dirty. Oh, it's not that he thinks it's dirty. So I don't know if you gathered in the prologue what happens when Log chases Carrie into the bedroom and then we hear the scream. Did anybody figure out what happens there?
I know.
A lot of people know. Well, Log rapes Carrie.
Ouch-a-wow-wow.
Oh, all right.
What does that have to do with Chuck?
Erica is Log's daughter. Okay. Erica was conceived
right.
during that rape, which means she's half Log, which means in my world she has bones made out of wood, and whatever guys.
Okay, I didn't know that. No.
Okay.
Well,
so
I'm setting up mystery boxes now. So originally, like, I that's something that's going to be revealed later. That Erica doesn't
right.
even know because she thinks
but
her father is Wyatt.
What does this have to do with Chuck not wanting to go down on Erica?
Because he went
you
down on her.
It out?
Hang on, he went down on her and he got splinters. He got a splinter on his tongue.
So why don't you have that scene in the script? Otherwise, it's a payoff with no setup. That's the problem. Have that scene previously. Can we? When's the introduction of Chuck? He's just
yeah,
introducing
you should introduce
that
it.
Scene, right?
I agree with that.
But how? Like, what I was going to do was later it's revealed that she has these wooden bones, and then that's like, oh, that's what happened.
A bandit on his tongue.
What?
All right, then you no, a bandit. You wouldn't put a
oh,
bandit on
no.
his tongue. Here's the solution. The solution is through an alteration to the dialogue in a later scene. What you would mm-hmm. do is have some sort of like reference to the fact that you know his tongue hurts or something.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, I can do that. Yeah, I can put that in the dialogue. And then what happens when they get to the camp is they try to have sex, and he gets a sliver on his finger. And then that's like clue number 2, basically.
Right, but wait, is there going to be that he gets a splinter in his tongue scene?
No.
Or is that backstory?
That's backstory. That's why they broke up. So basically we're meeting them. They've just broken up. I was trying to, like, put conflict between them, so it's like Erica and Chuck are fresh off a breakup, but he invites himself along because he's a plumber to help at this camp. And Todd,
I think
who wanted to get with
Erica.
You should
write that scene in there. it'll be one page. Have her and him hooking up. He goes down on her, gets the splinter. She gets pissed off. They argue and break up, and then, like, she cries. Then she gets, like, have, like, the connecting bridge between that scene and her having to get ready to go, and then he picks her up in the morning, and then it adds to the tension of the scene, the fact that we already met these characters, we know where they stand. It mm-hmm. shouldn't be backstory, it should be a page of scene right there.
Yeah, I could probably do that. I was thinking about deleting the beaver scene because somebody told me that
it's a natural enemy of Logs.
Yeah. Well, because she has wooden bones, somebody told me, like, wouldn't she hate beavers? So why do I have her saving a beaver? And I was like, oh, shit, you're right. Like, I was just trying to make her more likable in a funny kind of save the cat type moment.
It works. It, It works great. It's I thought that was one of the stronger scenes because of the inherent irony. You should ignore the notes the other person gave you.
Really?
As for why she would help a beaver, it's simple. It's because in the beginning, the hero is going against her own nature because she doesn't yet know herself.
Well, and
she
needs
to go through the story.
She's part human, too. So, I mean, she's got that.
She is. And I don't know if you guys picked up then on the termite thing. The reason that the termite bothers her so much when she's in the office is because termites eat wood. And she doesn't know why, but when she sees it, she just really hates it and wants to kill it. And then her anxiety keeps growing throughout the conversation. She can barely focus on what Lenny is saying until she smashes it, despite the fact that she hates germs and getting any kind of dirt on her. So that was supposed to be like another mystery box. With the termite, but I see what you're saying. Like, if I could keep the beaver scene, that's cool.
It doesn't really work as a mystery box simply because we know the script is called Log, and we know that there's a log going around killing people that's vampiric. So the connection between termites and beavers are just, these are the natural enemies of logs. It's allegorical. It's metaphorical.
Yeah, no, you get it's that, but you don't know that she has wooden bones.
Right, exactly. When you have the payoff of the fact that her bone was wood, it retroactively is a payoff. It's good writing. It's good.
Aw, thanks. Chess says he picked up on the termite thing. Awesome. Bode says moths eat sweets. Almighty says it's like me and moths. Okay, I'm just catching up on chat here. Let me read this really quick. So Chess says, oh gosh, we have a lot of comments here. Okay, Bode says, dang, how dry does she have to be to have splinters coming out? Word says wooden bones would be more flexible. She could be great at yoga. I don't know if it would be flexible unless she was wet and got warped, which is something I want to address. I'm thinking about giving her a fear of water. Serge says,
also mentioned if he were eating Erica out, wouldn't he taste sawdust in that case?
Right.
Yeah.
He could say
it would be more like sap. Like
syrup. There's sap coming.
It would be all
coming.
Sticky. Like, what the heck? Try to pull out. I can't.
Yeah. Boy, you guys, you're in for a treat if you like the idea of the sap thing. That is coming later. Let me keep reading on here. I feel like I'm doing a podcast, by the way. It's super awesome. Serge says, it's some hard wood for bones. Bode says, does it work through the skin like a bone sliver? I think yes, it does. Chess says, that wouldn't hurt if it's... Oh, that would hurt if it's in the nether regions poking through. Yeah, oh, right. Yeah, I don't think that it would be poking through her skin. She wouldn't innately hate beavers. Why would she hate beavers? We don't hate everything that chews on bones. That's true. Bode says, we love dogs. Right. It's like me and moths. Moths eat sweets. My bones are probably made of fabric. I picked up on the termite thing. Almighty says, I picked up on the termite thing too. They say to Bode, I hope not. Bode says, sap. I mean, she's a living being, right? Madge says, precisely, Bode. Bode said, she's not made of dry wood, but he is. And Clown says, bish. And I say bish too. So, did anyone stumble on anything? Was there any moment in the script where you were confused about what I meant?
No, it's incredibly straightforward. I think the only time I ever had an issue was the first line. I know it's only because my connection went out for a bit.
Okay.
I just had that issue with Kiwi. I wouldn't think that if she's kind of high, she wouldn't be like snappy. You know what I mean?
Right.
Like, I think she'd be more like, whoa, what happened to your neck? Or, you know.
Like a little more clueless.
Like
a little more clueless, not so on the ball of figuring out what might have happened to Erica.
Well, even if she was on the ball, just kind of have her a little more laid back about it. Like, just chill about it. It's no big. You know what I mean?
I see. Okay, gotcha. Yeah, I was just thinking about the conflict, you know, putting conflict between Kiwi and Chuck. But I can still do that and just, like, tone it down, maybe.
My only note would be something super simple, like at the bottom of page 7. You need to learn to use mini slugs. Erica opens the door, Chuck follows her. The carriage return inside all capitals. You don't need to have another scene break in interior. Continuous. Just use a mini slug.
Well,
there's a bunch of,
the first one is exterior.
Exactly.
Right? So I go from exterior to interior. So I need a new one when I go to interior, right?
No, you don't. No. You could just use a mini slug of her going inside. Yeah.
And what would the mini one say?
The mini slug could be inside. Follows her inside as a mini slug.
Just inside.
And you can there. Yep.
Make a note of that.
Yeah, that works.
I haven't seen that before. Now, just to verify, that's not just something that you do because you like to break the rules. It's something that other people do.
It's called a mini slug.
Yeah. Okay. I'm familiar with mini slugs. Like, for example, if you're in the house and it's like in the bathroom, in the living room, that kind of thing. I've done that. But I've never seen it when going from exterior to interior.
When you have a scene break, it's a complete break in the scene altogether, typically with time. That's why you have people write continuous to try to highlight the fact that there's no break. In scenes when you're just having a continuous from exterior to interior, using a mini slug is less invasive and it keeps the read moving forward. It's like a better thing to do.
I can see how that would be a better read, but I bet you they would change that before that goes to camera, because the first AD is going to need to break that up.
Yeah,
so the interior and the exterior.
You're not writing a shooting script, you're writing a spec script.
Right, yeah. Okay, so because it's a spec script. See, I'm a director too, right? So I see these things when they're on set, and that's one of the things that I think of. Mm-hmm. So that might be why I'm thinking I have to differentiate its exterior, interior.
Yep.
Okay, so I'm going to make a note of that. That's cool. I like that. There was actually, I missed a slug line when they were in the car and then they get out to see the beaver. So you might have just liked it better like that, but I didn't go from interior to exterior.
There's a bunch of places where you can use mini slugs in the script.
Yeah.
Like I counted like 5 or 10.
Whoa. That's a lot. Maybe if you have it
like interior car, exterior parking lot, that's a mini slug. Exterior house, interior house, that's a mini slug.
Cool.
You know?
I feel it's more so a stylistic thing, but yeah, when it comes to spec, you definitely want to be more of an easy reading.
Right. Yeah, I get that part of it. I like that idea.
You know, you're already directing on the page and you have scenes end off your look.
Yeah.
You know, like...
I know. Is
which
that
is
bad?
Fine, that's your style, it doesn't matter. But like, mini slugs are like, it's a little trick you can use that'll improve the readability. It's good stuff.
Cool. Cool. I like that. Let me catch up on the chat here for a second. Word says maybe Kiwi is having a bad high and she's more paranoid and violent. Okay, yeah. Chess says also using big words like dispensary is probably not good. Yeah, Judy, you didn't say dispensary. Is that because you weren't familiar with that word?
No, I didn't think she would be saying those kinds of words when she's partially high.
Okay. I don't know. I disagree. Dispensary is the word where you get the pot from in pot legal states like Colorado, Washington, and California.
Okay. Yeah, exactly.
And people say it all the time.
Yeah, here in Vancouver, it's a pretty common thing, even though it's technically not legal here. It is legal if you have a medical marijuana card. And the backstory on Kiwi is that her parents are very big marijuana activists, and they run a dispensary. So she.
Yeah, I kind of figured that out.
Yeah.
Her parents. Well, yeah. You can get rid of it. I thought it was fine. It was fine.
Okay, cool. That was just a personal choice by Judy.
I actually particularly liked the indica dominant strain with Fixie Write Up. Its character.
That's why I put that in there, Judy, was to show that like she's an expert because like she works at the dispensary too. Like she works with her parents and she goes to the protests and the 420 rallies and all that kind of stuff. Bode says mini banana slugs are delicious. Gross. Judy says, I like Word's idea, paranoid and over-observant. Yes, I do like that. But trying to break the overall tension, that, yes, definitely. Bode says, hey, I got to run. Great table read. Loved hearing. Log aloud. Thank you very much, Bode. Word says with a bad high, Kiwi would be antsy and jittery, mad at Dylan's driving, close to a panic attack. Antsy and jittery, mad at Dylan's driving, close to a panic attack. If it was a bad high, yes.
Maybe she's having a good high.
Yeah. Well, the way you read it, I think it was definitely a good high.
Yeah, I was seeing her more as laughing at everything, mm-hmm. So I don't know.
I think it would be a good high. I mean, she's got the good stuff, right? Strawberries and cream, man.
Yeah.
I love that.
Some of the timing was off, though, for her being suspicious at the same time setting up that she's sort of high all the time.
Yeah, no, I totally get that.
It's a little twisty there.
I get it. Yeah, that's a really good thing to find in a table read. That, like, for me, I had no idea. So that was really helpful. Word says, and with more than one drug, she could flip-flop between paranoia and gregarious. This is the 90s, though, right? No, this is present day. So the film opened in the 90s, like 1995, and then we cut to 21 years later when Erica is 21 years. So it's basically 2016. Cool. So any other comments or questions or anything someone wants to say that they liked or didn't like, lay it on me.
I liked Lenny, but if it is modern day... I feel like Dylan needs to be a little bit more brotastic.
Brotastic? Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep. Any suggestions how he would be?
Like more macho, like, I guess like...
Like over the top.
Like over the top, kind of peacocking.
That's a good word.
Obviously using, you know, like the word bro a lot.
Bro. Yeah, you're right. Yeah, bro. Yeah, bro. Bra. What's up, bro?
Yeah, like that. Yeah. Even like making up words that like coincide with the word bro, like the steam cool, you know, like Broseidon, stuff like that.
Broseidon.
Bromerica.
Bromerica.
There we go.
Bromerica.
Well, he's calling Erica America, so
yes, he is. Yes, he is.
But he could call Todd Bromerica.
He could. I love that. We watched a movie the other night called Dude Bro Party Massacre 3, where they were all bros saying bro
That's
every 2 seconds.
Is
it? Okay, that was a really funny movie. If anyone hasn't seen that, it's basically a spoof of horror movies, and every single character has a phobia and a flaw that is over the top and they have to overcome. It's called Dude Bro Party Massacre 3. And there
that sounds fantastic.
It is, and there's no one or two. There's only three. It's really, really funny, so definitely check it out. So Dylan would basically be like one of those bros. So, yeah, I think Dylan needs a bit more work on his dialogue. So that's a good note for me. I like that. Thanks, Vince.
Making a comment towards what Weird said, that I mean, Weird.
Weird.
Yeah,
Word is weird.
Word is weird. That's either
works. What Weird is saying, that Dylan seems more 60s macho. Make him like listen to the Beach Boys or something.
Well, he's wearing a Dio shirt, so
I
have
true.
To change so, that to a Beach
yeah,
Boys.
No, I'm kidding, though.
okay.
But, yeah, no, because what we were focusing is the dude bros of now. But what I was going to say, it's like, I'm such a huge anime fan that I thought you guys were talking about Dio from JoJo's Bizarre Adventure.
Oh, man.
So
if
you guys saw me say something really weird on the chat, I want to apologize.
I didn't even notice. What did you say?
Sawaruda. It's supposed to be the world in a very terrible Japanese accent.
Oh, wow. Well, yeah.
I didn't even notice.
I did see something with symbols. Maybe that was... No, that wasn't it. That was something to do with bones. Well, no, I was talking about Dio, the heavy metal band.
Wow, I'm an idiot.
No, you're not. You're not an idiot.
I feel somewhat embarrassed that I missed that.
It's okay. So he's into the heavy metal, you know, he's got his chrome skull steering wheel and his bitchin' Firebird, which is my car, by the way. Most people know that. I drive an 88 Firebird that looks exactly like that, white with the red bird on the hood and the flames on the side. It's totally bitchin'.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I went to go pick something up from the post office today and I parked my car and I got out and this guy was walking by and he was like, oh, what did he say? Did he say retro? Oh, no, he said old school. That's what he said. He's walking by. It's like old school.
Like just like that?
Like that, exactly like that. And I was like, yeah, I know. And then I put
the
money in
the
meter.
By the way, the answer word, the band Dio is actually Like, Dio was the lead vocalist for Black Sabbath at one point, and then he did his own thing.
Oh, was he? I didn't even know that.
Yeah, there was a small point in time where he was a Black Sabbath lead singer.
Almighty has a question. A Norwegian band would never call themselves Blood, Death, Fire. That is the song title. The band name is Death Face. And that band name was a suggestion from someone in chat. I can't remember who it was right now. It might have been Sharpman. It might have been Bode. But yeah, they're called Death Face, and the song is called Blood, Death, Fire, which is a real song by some black death metal band, which later, we're going to meet this band as they trudge out to the woods for a photo shoot slash music video.
Sounds like a black metal band.
Yeah.
It's a good setup.
Yeah, it's all to set up a joke where they eventually get killed in a fire. And this crime this crime scene investigator comes along and with a photographer, and they take a picture of the band like all splayed out with their melted guitars dead, and he shows it to the investigator, and the investigator says, "That would make an epic album cover." Just because of the joke of all the Scandinavian metal bands that have gone missing in the woods, taking album cover photo shoots.
There was a, I think, either black or death metal band that their lead vocalist committed suicide, and they, the band actually used the picture of, like, him with a shotgun.
No way. Oh my god, that sounds kind of familiar.
Yeah, I think the name of the band was something simple, too, kind of like death or something like that, but I don't...
Right.
I'm not too familiar with metal. Death. I grew up more so with punk, thanks to my older brother, so...
Bitchin'. Yeah, I'm not super familiar with metal either, but that was actually a suggestion, again, from chat, because I wrote this entire script on Twitch. Somebody said, you should have a Scandinavian metal band that comes out to the woods for a photo shoot and then Log kills them. And then I was like, yes, that sounds awesome. And they made it into the script. A lot of lines of dialogue were suggestions from people in the chat. So I really have been taking everything and stealing it. Wahaha. All right, so it is 5:35 my time, so we've been going for an hour and 35 minutes, and I think now would probably be a good time for me to start making dinner. Does anyone have any final thoughts, things they want to say?
Yeah, when are we going to do another live reading?
Good question. So I feel like this was a success, and it went really well, and you guys did amazing, so I would love to do it again. I won't have any of my own material, but if somebody else has material that they think would be well suited for a table read,
I totally have material that could be used for it.
I'll bet you do, Greg. Of course you do.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What I was gonna say, it's like I'm actually down to do more of like these table reads myself.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing is my schedule is a little weird, but just message me through Discord, I guess, and let me know what's up.
Yeah. Vince, do you want to just grab the mic for a second since you're our other Twitch film administrator?
Okay, so if anyone has any scripts they want to bring to the table, send me a personal message via Discord with the script if you have it. And also, like what Smishmosh did, if you could do a character sheet so we know the characters that are going to be in it, so people can pick if they want to. And we'll do the same thing. We'll do like the first 20 so pages. But we want to try and do this weekly. If we don't have like submissions by the end of the week, we'll probably pick something off of Script Shadow to read.
I'm down. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Again, let me know. I would definitely like to do that more.
That's awesome. Yeah, you did a great job reading. Everybody did a great job reading. And I would be happy to read, you know, for somebody else's script. I would really have fun doing that. It's always fun doing table reads, and I think it's a good way to learn. Especially, you know, the conversation that we have at the end. We got some really good bits of advice from everybody here, so I want to do it. So I want to give a big thank you to everyone who was a reader today. Erica, Fallen Clown, Judy, Greg, Serge, Vince. Round of applause for you guys. Push to talk your applause. You guys did amazing. Thank you. Erica, you're awesome. You were great as our protagonist, Erica, and Carrie, really, really good. That was super fun. Thank you to everyone who posted my channel today so that we had a lot of viewers. At one point, we had like 23, which is more than I usually have. So that was really cool. Maybe we'll have more next time. Thanks everybody who watched and participated. I hope you enjoyed it. I'm going to go ahead and put dinner in the oven, and then maybe I'll throw a movie on Rabbit if people are hanging out in the Discord. I think I'm going to put Critters on tonight, so if anyone wants to watch Critters with me, get onto the Twitch Film Discord, and I'll post the instructions in there. So that's a wrap, everybody. Thanks so much. I'm going to go off Twitch now, and I'll talk to you guys later.
Good night. Peace, y'all.
Good night.
See you, guys.
Okay, I'm already off now.
Women.
Twitch stream is over. Nope. Sorry.
Wow.
It's my first time. I need a script. I need a script that I can follow so I know what to say. I was just kind of flying by the seat of my pants, but I think that went really well, you guys. What do you think?
I liked it.
It was awesome.
Yeah, cool.